So we've come to the Pescadero Basin to not only explore some new habitats, but follow up on hypotheses that we had when we visited here in 2018.
So this was a very special expedition that was broken up into three different legs. And we started off with our mapping team to also leverage autonomous underwater vehicles that are designed to do mapping at much higher resolutions. And in leg two, they were using a technique known as heat flow to look at the basically thermal gradients that exist close to the vent and going away from the vent. And then leg three has been devoted to the biology and microbiology. Really, it's this combination of this interdisciplinary research that's allowing us to understand these magical ecosystems as a whole entire environment.
Here we are in the Pescadero Basin with a hydrothermal vent system that is the deepest in the Pacific. If we don't have light, we need something like chemosynthesis. Bacteria have been happily doing that for probably millions, if not billions of years.
And what's happening in chemosynthesis is that the microbes are utilizing a different energy source. So rather than using energy from the sun, they're using energy from reduced chemicals coming from these underwater volcanoes or coming from the activities of other microbes. So the entire base of the food chain there is chemosynthesis, and sometimes animals can actually form these partnerships in order to also gain their nutrition. I actually equate symbiosis with innovation. So these animals and these microbes, they're innovating in ways that we really didn't expect. The anemone that we discovered in the Pescadero Basin, they are doing something unlike any other deep sea anemone. So they are hosting sulfide oxidizing symbionts in their tentacles.
Oasisia, it's incredibly abundant. The Oasisia may be evolved here in this deeper site. It's where it's happy. Xenotabella, well, this is a worm that we found here. It's so strange that we're still trying to figure out where it belongs. So another worm that is a new species from Pescadero is Haina leopolinoi orphani, who was named for Victoria, our chief scientist on this expedition. Well, I'm most impressed by their color. It really is amazing. It's not from pigment, it's from light refracting.
So I think it's really also quite fascinating how dynamic these habitats are, and they are changing dramatically. So we had this site called the Big Cavern, and we had seen it in 2018. It was very spectacular. And we got there and the entire structure had collapsed.
In losing all of this fluid in there, we also were able to see the back wall of the cavern and discover new kinds of minerals back there that weren't accessible before. And so there were new discoveries to be made, even though the feature itself had started to collapse.
So our discovery at what we were calling the midway point was really exciting. We knew that this was a feature that we really wanted to get eyes on.
If I'm totally honest, I was a little bit disappointed when we first landed, because it really did look like it was a feature that was once very active, but no longer. And then we came up over the ridge and it was the most beautiful scene.
It is a really dynamic habitat. It has two worm forests and anemones. The structures were pretty novel. So some of them looked like big serpents and dragons.
Nothing compares to being able to see something for the first time like that. What is it about the microbes? Why do we even care about this? It matters a lot because these organisms are the controllers of all of the geochemical cycles on Earth. Really, the way the planet works is all connected to the activities of these microorganisms. So our understanding of microbial ecosystems is really well integrated with our ability to understand how our planet operates.